So from the idea of the workshop, it was where to start with what is what is the potential on implementing the landscape convention, how to use the implementation process in the different countries. Why is this relevant? So I will just go shortly through the European Landscape Convention, but what we discussed in Valladolid is already we have two different policy areas where in the more, or let's say policy theaters in Europe, where we are addressing at the moment with the outcome of this project, where we are addressing certain developments. One is the Council of Europe with the implementation of the Landscape Convention. They are interested to have regional concepts of implementation. And we have suggested to the national representative, because us as an NGO network, we can't table a recommendation or paper. We have to ask the national representatives, is it the national interest to table it in this conference? But from the feedback, we know that the Spanish, the Italian, the Irish, and the Norwegian are interested to use the outcome of this project, the toolbox, to draft a recommendation on the regional implementation of the Landscape Convention. And that would be quite fruitful because that will go to the Landscape Conference in 2019 and will be in the same year, if we pass through that, adopted by the ministers. That means it would be a feedback on the national level saying, okay, for the regional implementation, these are the recommendations. What means also, it will open up a way how to organize projects, implementation projects at regional level, and what kind of support you need from the national level, and what kind of support you are looking from European level at the same time. When it comes to funding, in most cases we are mainly looking on the European Union, and so therefore we have started to with talks on the European level. So in Valladolid, I informed you that I'm in the high-level consultation for the European Cultural Heritage here, as one of the experts there. And so in the first meeting, one question was, who should be addressed in this process of the Cultural Heritage here? So it's a communication, but also what is in a strategic way, what is expected as a potential outcome, who should be addressed. And I made with other networks from the European Heritage Alliance, so Brian will talk about that later, we stress the importance to involve policymakers on regional level, on local level, because it's not a problem to have concepts on European level. It's now the question how to have an implementation, successful implementation on the local, on the regional level, and how to achieve this. And they are clearly interested to learn what kind of toolbox we are producing and how this could be used on coastal region, but maybe also for other regions, depending on how we are developing it. Okay, this is a little bit the background setting. Okay, I think I will do it very quick. So one main thing is to see the quality and diversity of European landscape. As I mentioned, we have very diverse partners around the table in this project, with the channel, with the river, with coastal things. And not only this, yesterday Alicia pointed out, of course, we have also administrative differences. And that is also, when you look on the implementation of the Landscape Convention, one of the strengths is it's not like an EU directive saying you have to do it in this and this way, because it has to meet the setting, the administrative setting, but also governance setting in each country. And it means when we develop the toolbox, we will use best practice example, which are a very good example from a certain region, But we have to aware this is not something we could use one-to-one in another region, because we have another governance form and we have another administration setting there. And so we have to look how we can make this adaptive and how to take these differences in account. We think that the ELC is quite a good convention in the implementation, because it looks not only on the protection, for example, of cultural heritage or natural heritage in the landscape, it looks also on the management and on the planning. So it is also a view what could be come in future, how we are preparing for that, and that means in terms of climatic change, how we can we ensure that cultural heritage management is able to meet these challenges which are coming up. Yeah, and then I think one central aspect in it is, I always talk about that, but landscape means an area perceived by people. And that means landscape is not just the physical landscape. Of course, this is part of what we see in landscape, but it's dependent on the perception. And that means different people might have different perceptions. And that is sometimes, if you look on tourism development, which is quite difficult to see, that maybe local people see their coastal landscape different from tourists visiting the same area, seeing the same things, but have different meanings for them, for a certain reason, because it's this view on landscape, so the social construction is dependent on your tradition, on your knowledge, on your social relation, and this might differ. And that might even differ in a region. Think about people arriving new in a region. Yeah, they might look differently on the landscape and also on the cultural heritage. Because what we learned from Lindy's introductions in the project is also that cultural heritage is more a process than just objects. It is how people look on this, how it has a meaning for them, and it is also the strong point of policy making, because policy making will not start with just collecting a number of objects which are, let's say, from an expert view, are relevant. It's also how people look on it and how they perceive it and how they give this object or landscape or ensembles a meaning and an importance, which also allow policymakers to allocate fundings to that. So in this way, I think we can quite perfectly use the logic in the landscape convention. One thing is that landscape policy is clearly, the idea is clearly that it's an expression of competent public authorities. So it's not, we have a lot of participatory aspects in this implementation, but clearly the administration, these are the people which are developing the concept or which facilitate participatory processes. So to ensure that the public is involved, that stakeholders are involved, which are necessary to achieve the next steps in the process. Yeah, and one thing, I've also presented that in Norway, is this idea of quality objectives. So in Ireland, the government has now published the landscape strategy. Ireland is on the way to implement it. Norway is implementing the convention since years. But now in Norway, they also start to think about more of this aspect of landscape quality objectives. So quality objective means you have a kind of agreement between the different stakeholders, maybe with their different perception on what is the quality of a certain landscape. So that means also when we talk about the Jurassic coastline here, yeah, what are the characteristics in this and what makes the quality? What is necessary to preserve to have these areas of outstanding natural beauty? how to keep it and where are they vulnerable. And in this way, there's a chance to use this quality objectives. Yeah, and the central promise, and that is something we will deal in the next Marinescape Forum, is people must have a say on their landscape, so how to involve a wider public in these planning processes. Because what we see in the moment is quite, if you go to urban landscapes, but also in rural landscapes, so more and more people are interested to have a say, so to influence it in a certain way, which doesn't mean they will be present in the whole process. Might be that at a certain point they have a position or they try to influence it in their way, but this is something which will change our governance in landscape and also in cultural heritage for sure in the next years. Yeah, because people start looking on it more differently. If I look on the development over the last years, so Michael Dauer, when he was general director of the Countryside Commission here in the UK, that was in a time where, as an expert, he had quite strong standing. So you can give an opinion about what is relevant, what are the necessary things to do. And what we see over the time, that we have an erosion of this acceptance of experts, doesn't mean they are not accepted in the end. Yeah, but the process is more, it starts becoming more open. And let's say the worst discussion might be what we see in the moment in the US, this fake news, fake facts, where people say, well, I don't believe it, I just prepare my own facts. And that makes it quite important to think about how to make evidence-based policy. Yeah, how to identify important facts in the process, how to use it, and how to ensure that in the end project will provide such facts, which are the next steps you can build on and continue with the development of policy, cultural heritage policy, but also, for example, in shaping action plans to look what are the next steps in front. Okay. So just this. Yeah. Not to be too long, but so with the what I mentioned in the beginning in my short presentation was how to address the different levels. And oh, I thought it is like a presentation. Okay. Okay. One thing is the landscape conference. So this is the conference of the signatory states, and this is the conference which can, for example, decide on recommendations. They have already adopted some recommendation on the implementation. Now they are looking on how to do it on regional and local level. And we said it would be more realistic to involve regional and local authorities in this process drafting it. And therefore, our project could be really an important stepstone in the process. And the other things are these workshops. In the workshops, you have the national representatives also there, but also practitioners from different countries giving examples how they have implemented the landscape convention or how they work on a certain aspect. So that means this is more where you exchange experiences and have an exchange between different projects, can learn some on maybe some new approaches. What is coming up in the moment is ELKIS. This is the European Landscape Convention information system. It is run by the Council of Europe. On the last landscape conference, that was in March, it was finally approved that it will be used in the full scale. So that means, for example, all signatory states will report through this system about the implementation, and all signatory states have agreed that the regions will have access and can also bring in their projects, their implementation strategies in this system. I'm not sure that it will happen this year or next year, so we will see, it might be a longer process. But this is on one hand something we can take information from, but also put in information in the process on the, let's say, on the mid-range. Okay, this is it for the moment.